going to be starting our next 2 hours with our advanced sequencing with Michael Stoffregen from Showstopper Sequences. The previous two sessions were fantastic, a lot of participation. Please remember to visit our vendors. We'll put the link in the chat.
Ah, welcome. We're winding down. This has been quite a challenge for me to sit and talk for 5 hours, but we'll see how it goes. This is the advanced xLights sequencing, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to cover a variety of topics not particularly joined together. So one of the things that we will do is before I switch gears and go to a different topic, we'll ask questions. That way you don't have to try to remember it to the end of the 2 hour session. In addition, you can get your answer while it's still fresh on your mind and it's more meaningful to you. All right. So anyway, I'm with Showstopper Sequences. The purpose of this is basically we're going to build on your knowledge to enhance your sequencing. You know, the good thing about this is obviously if you're here in the advanced, you have some level of comfort with sequencing. So the stuff I'm trying to cover for you is stuff that hopefully will make your sequencing better just for yourself. These are the topics. I'm not going to break this out, but we are going to get into the new submodeling tools using SVGs in the sketch effect and the shapes effect, using Moise's AI, a little program called Magic. It was a big hit down in the Florida Mega Mini. Show you some things with Mid Journey and go into some tree manipulations that you might find useful, mega tree manipulations that you might find useful. Ah, well, that was wrong. I hit the wrong button. What am I gonna do? I'll start over, that's what. Okay, so there we go. All right, so I'm going to switch over now. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to share the screen. On my xLights. Okay. Can somebody tell me if we are, you can see the xLights screen? I think you can.
No, just the presentation.
Just the presentation. All right. Maybe I can fix that this way. There we are. Should be able to see it now.
Yep, all good.
Awesome, thank you. Okay, this is just some things that I put together. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you one of the new tools in xLights as it relates to creating submodels. I think this is one of the more exciting tools that we've had added to it, particularly from the production side of a commercial sequencer. And also, I know the Coral Props guys really like it as well. This prop here is the Showstopper spinner. It's one that EFL Designs and I put together. I put together the submodels. As you probably know, there are a bunch of submodels there, an incredible amount. And the advantage of having a lot of submodels is it allows us to change the look of our prop. Okay, I just downloaded the Mesmerizer, just picked one. This is a Buscoyo prop. And I haven't really done anything with it before, but I'm gonna go in And I'm going to take a look at some of the things that they've got. This is their existing submodels that they have. Now, I've never manipulated this, but I will tell you, one of the things that is a given is that anytime you have, let me see here, make sure you can see it. Anytime you have a submodel, you want to make sure that the submodels, like the layers in your display, you want to make sure that the submodels go from the largest to the smallest. So I'm gonna grab a couple of things here and just change the order. I'm gonna drag them up to the top. And the ones where it's broken out, we'll leave those at the bottom. And the reason why we put the larger props, excuse me, the larger submodels at the top is so that the smaller ones can then modify them. Because the rule is with submodels, we go from the bottom up to modify, basically. So anything on the bottom is going to trump what's up on the top. So what you want, if you've got a submodel like this that takes up a whole lot, you're going to want it towards the top. That one's a little less, so I'm going to move it down. Inner rings, that's a smaller also, move it down. Diamonds is pretty big. That one's a lot bigger than the diamonds. Let's see if it, compare it to the star, it's about the same. Matrix takes up a whole bunch. I'm just going to move it all the way up. And that's just spoke one, goes there. Checker one, quite a bit. Checker two, quite a bit. Okay, so you're going to want this to be in order. All right, let me show you the new tool. And it, if you haven't used it, you need to just start trying things. Okay, I'm going to add a prop. And I'm going to bring this over to the side. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a single arm. And I'm going to skip the center. And I'm going to start varying this a little bit. Now, when you create submodels, you'll notice I'm just grabbing them kind of one at a time. And I'm going to slowly meander around. And then I think here at the end, what I'm going to do is just create kind of a circle. Okay, so that's one arm of our new prop, our new submodel. If I come over here and I right click, and I'm going to tell it to symmetrize it. Now, what I don't know is how many it will accept. If I get an error, I'm going to back it off, but I'm going to try doing 12 to start with. And we're not using the center node, so I don't need that. Okay, so now I've created this submodel. And usually what I'll do, I'm going to bring it all the way to the top here. Make it a little easier to find. Okay, that's how easy it is to create a submodel, because that the new tools that are available in xLights allow you to go in and duplicate those arms completely. All right, so let me take that one right there. What I'm gonna do is see if I can get maybe a couple more in there. It looks like there's a little more room. Okay, I'm going to symmetricize, and last time I did 12, this time, see if it'll do 16. Okay, didn't like it, so nope, no 16. Try it again. This time I'm going to try 14. Nope, didn't like that. So it looks like 12 is the best we're going to be able to do with that. So we got 12 rotations. Nope. Okay, there we are. All right, so I'm just going to call that submodel squiggle for no other reason than that's what it looks like to me. Tell it okay. I'm going to save it. Go to the sequencer. I'm going to make a little new sequence. It's just going to be an animation. 40 frames per second, quick start. Make sure that mesmerizer has been added in. Yes, it is. Sort these by name, but groups at top. Okay, there it is. All right, so that's the prop, and the squiggle is the new submodel that we added. I'm going to add a little timing mark here. Now what I'm going to do is I am going to test it. The way I'm going to test it is I'm going to take a single line effect, and I'm going to put it on that prop. Now, it's set now to the default, so it's going to do everything all at once the same. So let me change the colors on that a little bit. End it with a blue. I'm going to change the render style to single line. Now, let me get over to the effect settings. All right, we know that there are 12 rotations in there. So I'm going to add it, the number of chases to 12. All right, so that's going to give us the 12. And I'm going to reduce the chase size down so there's a little space in between the colors, so it's not just a constant color. Usually I find 4 gives you some neat effects. It looks really good. And then the cycles, I'm just going to up them to about 3. All right, so let me pull this out so you can see it. Okay, so that's a new effect that we created for the mesmerizer that did not exist before. Very, very simple. When it comes to sequencing, all I did was put on a single line, change the render style to a single strand rather, change the render style to single line, change the number of chases to 12, and we get to see it. Now, I'll show you some things about the number of chases that's really handy. If I reduce it to 6, okay, now we get every other one and it rotates. You can see there's a slight rotation to the model. If I put it on 11, okay, we get that kind of spiral, almost a galaxy or a nautilus shell type of look. If we put it on a 10, we're going to get 2 of those. And if we go past 12, we start getting other rotations caused by the overlap. And we can get some pretty crazy things as we get bigger and bigger and bigger. All right, so that's really the key to a good submodel, is to be able to come in, drop a single line effect on it, change the number of chases, and get different effects, different looks, just by changing the number of chases and the chase size. If I change the chase size and fill everything in, it looks a little different. Now, that one is dropping the chase size down to 1. I'm going to make that a little bigger, and I'm going to eliminate the red and the blue so you can see better what it's doing. Okay, that's the chases there are on 10. And if I put it on 11, you'll see I've just got the single one. I just switched it to white, so it'd be a little easier for you to see. But that's when the chase size is 1. Chase size 4, I'm going to add some color back in. All right, so we've, from a single submodel, we've been able to get a whole lot of different looks. Now, before I go on and cover anything else, I do want to ask if there are any questions about this new tool and how you would use it. So if you could unmute their mics and I'll see if they've got any questions.
Just unmute yourselves if you have a question to ask.
I saw you did that with a rotation. If that's a regular matrix, do you do some kind of vertical or horizontal kind of a repeat?
No, and here's why. It is a rotational tool. In other words, it won't work on like a half arch or something like that. I wish it did. I don't know if there's a way that, you know, that they could mathematically subtract out the elements you don't need or, you know, temporarily duplicate them, because if it can't find a matching pixel in the right position, then it won't, it gives you that error that we saw when I tried to increase the number of arms.
So whatever it is has to be symmetrical effectively all the way around in the center.
Basically, yes. There has to be a way for the program to find the repeating pixels. Like if I had spent some time on the error message that it generated, it'll tell you could not find pixels for, you know, a matching pixel for this node, this number. So it actually goes in and tries to find the matching one. Okay, so there are some other tools that are included in there. I don't use them a whole lot, but they are in there. Let me get back into the submodels. Got our squiggle there. Another thing that you can do, if you right click, you can remove duplicates, suppress them, you know, different ways to do things. The reason why duplicates can sometimes be an issue is that if these arms here overlap one another, where there's an overlap, the first arm in the list here gets to claim the overlapping pixel. It drops out on the subsequent ones. So if you have a whole lot of overlap, what can happen is you end up with significant dropout. And if that happens, what you can do is take these breakouts here, like the spoke, you know, 1 through 24, and you can create a group outside of the model itself. And by doing that, you can actually avoid the pixel dropouts. Now, the performance is a little different, and you're going to have an extra group listed in your sequencing list, you know, all your props when they're listed there, you're going to have an extra group there. But it does avoid the dropout. Now, these right here, these spokes, nice little tool that they have, because this was not in the mesmerizer. I'm going to right click and I'm going to select that. I just hold down the shift key and use the left click to select 1 through 24. And then what I can do is join them. And now that I have joined them, I can call that submodel spokes. Now, because there's no overlap, let me just save that, tell it okay, save, go back into the submodels. Because there is no overlap on those spokes, they are all individuals, there's no overlap, what I can do is actually take it and use it in the model itself without creating a separate submodel. Now, if I do something like that, then I can actually delete those. Let's see if it'll let me delete those. Yeah, all 24. Because now I have the spokes that are the same. Now, one of the things I'll show you here on this model, you'll see here, it's got a long spoke and a short spoke. How do you make those line up? Now, the reason why you would want to do that is because, and I'm going to use the uniform row length. Oh, didn't do it. Yeah. Okay, you'll see here what it did was it added in some extra commas at certain points. And what that does is it makes the short ones the same length as the long ones. Now, why would you do that? Well, very simply, because if you put like a shockwave on this, and now that everything has been made the same length, and like I said, it's kind of real, I'm sure it's really hard for you to see, but there are an extra comma added where there's not a pixel in the short spokes. So it made them all the same length. So when you put a shockwave on there, it's going to start at the center and go out to the end, and it will end on all of the spokes at the same time. So when you have uneven spokes like that, that's something one of the tools that you would want to do. And like I said, it goes in and it automatically adds commas where there are no pixels in the short ones. So technically, adding those commas makes those spokes the same length. All right, so again, that's another one of the tools that they have available. Let me show you some other things that you can do. I'm gonna add one. Let's see what we can do. Just slowly going out. Okay, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Again, I'm gonna try to symmetricize it with 12. Okay, and now we have kind of a whirligig that we didn't have before. Call that swirl right. And again, we want them all the way up because it covers a lot of it. All right, so you can see how it's pretty easy to start generating a lot of different submodels. And again, the advantage of having those submodels is that, you know, it takes a prop here and now you can drop a single effect on it, maybe two, and have it looking great. Whereas before, I would say that's pretty much like a circular matrix because there are so many pixels on there. And sometimes it makes it really hard to make those things look good. You'll have to add, you know, 3-4 layers and things like that to get it looking good. Whereas if you can create good submodels, you can create all kinds of nice little effects with it. Okay, so that's basically what we've got. Let me show you, and I'm going to use this one. Let me get into the sequencer. I'm going to actually create a new sequence. We're going to discard any changes. Musical sequence. This is the song I've been using all day. Okay, quick start. I'm just going to use the Queen Mary Vamp plugins at this time and add a beat track to it. Oops, that's the wrong one. There it is, Bar and Beat Tracker Beats. Okay, so now I've got some timing marks that I can drop some things into. I'm going to go down to the Showstopper Spinner again because I'm probably the most familiar with that one. And I'll show you how you can sequence with this, and it's just very, very easy to do. All right, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take a single strand. I'm going to put it on, let's say, just the circles. And I'm going to spread it out a little bit. It is a single line render style. And I'm going to make it 12. And the reason why is because it's 12 lines, 12 circles. So I know that 12 is going to make it bounce a little bit. Okay, I'm going to play a little bit of the music. Okay, it looks like on the beats, we're hitting it twice as fast. I'm going to reduce the cycles to 1.5 on that. Okay, it's a little off. I'm trying a little faster. Still not quite fast enough. Jump that up to 1.8. Okay, so what I'm looking for on the model, the way I'm setting the cycles, what I'm trying to do is while it's playing, I want the claps to coincide with the it hitting in the middle. Okay, so you can see how it matches. All right, so now I've got that. I'm going to right click and I'm going to copy that. Now I don't have any dividers set up, but if I don't like what's happening here, I can just start going down the list. I'm using the arrow key, just taking it down to the next one. Now I know the timing is right because I've already got the timing set. So that's what that submodel looks like. Okay, so that's not bad. Maybe not what I want. Okay, this is Big Pedals is the submodel. All right, that's not too bad. I like that one, the way it looks. That's everything. And like I said, since I know the timing's right, I'm gonna copy it. And now I'm going to go to maybe another submodel. Let me go down here. Let's do. Swirl right. I'm going to drop that in there. No, that's not on swirl right. That's a spinner. Sorry. Missed it by one. Okay, so that's the swirl right. So now we're here. All right. Let's say I want to shorten that down a little bit. Okay. Then I'll come over here and I'm going to reduce that cycles down to 0.9. It'll be again pretty close. Now I'm going to come down here to the fireworks. And I'm going to put that in there. Now it's set on 12. I want kind of a rotation on that. So let me put it on 11. And that's what we've got now. So started there. Transition to that one. It's that easy to sequence a well laid out model. And what I mean by that is you can just go in and you can take the same effect, you can drop it, manipulate the lengths. Usually I'll have the sequence broken up by sections and I'll do a section at a time. And you know, if I wanna mix things up a little bit, I can throw in some flashing. You know, just do something to the beats. Usually I've got things down here like the stars. You know, I can come down here. I can put in a VU meter. Tell it to timing event, pulse color. I'm just going to make it white. The timing event is the beats. And now it's got a little snap to it, a little pop, something like that. And it makes it very easy to sequence, very easy to layer. Too often, you know, you'll have these big spinners that don't have a lot of submodels with them, and you end up having to, you know, use a lot of spinners. And there's nothing wrong with the spinners. I mean, I use them all the time. But really, you know, there are better things out there that you can use. Let me move that one around so we can see it. A lot of times with the spinners, you'll have to go to per preview. Let's change the arms to 12. Make it thick. Make it 3D. Give it a twist, maybe. Okay, so spinners look great. There's nothing wrong with it at all. And you know, you can use that as part of it, pinwheels rather, on it. But it's very, very easy to sequence. And I just wanted to point that out to people, because if you have a very dense, high density prop and you're struggling with coming up with new ways to sequence it, look at going in and creating some additional submodels. And again, that's just something that will help you. Okay, so any questions about the methodology that I use to sequence with a high density prop that's, like I said, it's got good submodels? Any questions about that?
I guess what I found interesting about that symmetrical rotation and stuff you did is how it did the wiring layout for the, you know, for the end pixels. I thought it would actually do the wiring per arm, you know, the pixel advance, but it actually puts one pixel per arm and then advances to the next pixel per arm. And that's how you got all those animations to work, I think, how they did, right? It's how it did the pixel numbering. Does that make sense?
Yeah. The guy, I can't think of his name right now, but his username is Marion Cherry. He or his display, and guy's a genius as far as I'm concerned with what he came up with. I mean, it's amazing. It does a lot more stuff than what I understand, but yeah, it's amazing tool. It really is, and I think you can see how easy it is to make a nice looking spinner if you've got just the right, you know, if you've got the right submodels and they're set up correctly, then you can do all kinds of things.
Did you say you can draw those symmetrical rotations on a matrix too?
No, they will not.
Oh.
No, unfortunately, they do not. You know, I've got a tool here that I'll show you here in a bit that you can use on matrices that are real handy. But anyway, so anyway, that's what I wanted to cover on creating the submodels and the way that I sequence with them. No other questions. I'll just move on to the next topic. And one of the questions Justin McCown had was that the comma that it adds are the same as adding in another number. And that's true. It is. You know, I guess a zero or an exclamation mark, he said. And yeah, the thing is, it does it for you. So you don't have to figure out exactly where it's going to be when you try to equalize those spoke arms. Okay, so now the next thing we're going to cover, this is really a fun tool. And it hasn't gotten a lot of airplay, as they say. Let me get over here to the new timing, get rid of all those beats, delete the stuff I laid in there. All right, now go down to my mega tree. And I'm going to add some layers. Okay, it was a year ago in, I want to say January. No, it was May. A year ago from May at Transworld. And Clyde and myself and some of the other sequencers, we were all sitting around, we're talking, and the topic was, what would you like to see added to xLights? And I said, you know, I would really like to see graphic pictures added to the shapes effect. Okay, that's this one up here at the top, the shape effect. Okay, you drop it in, the default is a circle. There's all sorts of options you have. And it was funny because Keith said, no way, it can't happen. And then about, it was 3 or 4 months later, he added in the ability to add an SVG. All right, an SVG is a type of graphics file. It is a vector graphics. You will see it most often used with people who have like Cricut cutters, you know, who are cutting vinyl. That's the file format that they will use, is the SVG. All right, so let me pick an SVG and I'll show you what you can do with it. Make sure I get the right one. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Okay, I picked a snowflake SVG and put it on using that. And now all of a sudden we get this really neat snowflake pattern that is automatically generated by the shape effect. Now, not all SVGs work. For example, if they've got a gradient in them, they will not work for that. But you can add some really neat things on and just let it do its thing. The other thing you can do with that is, of course, you can change the velocity a little bit. And let's change the directions because we don't want our snowflakes going up in this instance. Okay, about 270. Now we've got snowflakes that come in and they kind of grow and then they fade out. You can adjust the growth by adjusting that parameter so that they don't get as big. You can adjust the lifetime so they last a little longer. Although I think they look a little better if they fade quicker. All right, so that's a pretty neat little tool that you've got, because now all of a sudden you've got your mega tree. Let me drop that down one. Let me come over here. Let's make it blue. Go over to the make it horizontal fade. And change the settings to layered. Give it some sparkles. Okay, pretty neat effect, pretty easy to do just by adding in the SVGs. All right, so just wanted to show you that. Now, let me come over here. And really, you're only limited by, you know, the SVGs that you can create, the ones that you want. Here's some of the ones that I've created. This is nested pink hearts. I'm going to eliminate the fade away on those. So they'll just pop instead of fading away. So it's a real quick hand way to do some things that are kind of cool. Now, how do you get your SVGs? Well, you can do a search on Google, obviously, to create SVGs. I use a graphics program called CorelDRAW, and it's pretty easy to create an SVG with it. There is another one that is called, hang on a second here. Got to get to my desktop, get the name of it so I don't lead you wrong. There's another program called Inkscape, and it's free. And what you need is you need a program that can do what they call tracing. And let me call up, like I said, I'm going to have to get to my CorelDRAW. All right, and I'm going to import just something Christmas related here. Okay, this is a PNG, it's a bow, and I'm going to import it. Okay, nice looking little bow. Hopefully you can see it. I'll make it as big as I can there. And in CorelDRAW, I can go in and I can trace this. It's an outline trace. Tell it it's a high quality image. It's removing the background right now. Okay, we're going to get rid of that's the image that it created. We're going to get rid of that one. We're going to save that as, I'm going to take this object, I'm going to make it bigger, just because what I found is that the xLights likes it when it's pretty big. So I'm going to make that image pretty big. And now I'm going to do File, Save As. And I'm going to go to where we are right now. And I'm going to save it as an SVG. Call it bow. Okay, no issues. And let's see if we can get that to show up on our tree now. Like I said, not all of them work all the time. But that one does. Okay, so now we've got this bow. Unfortunately, I think it's growing too much, so I'm going to reduce the growth down to 5. I can also decrease the speed so they're stationary. And now our tree has bows on it that come in, and we use them all over the place. Okay, before I switch over to showing you how we use those with the sketch effect, again, any questions before I switch gears?
Have you found any tricks on the SVGs to keep the level of detail? I'm noticing that you got really good detail on those bows.
You know, it seems to work pretty well with the CorelDRAW. Other programs I can't speak to as to, you know, how well they convert them. What's really interesting about the SVGs, hopefully you can see what I'm doing here. Might have to change my screen sharing, depends on what this does. Okay, this is Notepad++. I'm going to open up that SVG that I just created. And what's really interesting is it's a series of paths that are in there, and each path is defined by coordinates. In other words, it's really just drawing commands. And you can, the program is able to handle drawings real very well as it goes through there. Like I said, this one's pretty complex. We're looking at, it's made out of 804 separate paths that are drawn one by one. It's just that the program is so quick that you don't even notice that. So, like I said, xLights can handle it. Keith has a caveat that anything with a big gradient pattern just doesn't work that well. But I've yet to find one that's had a problem because of the gradient itself. All right, so that's where we're at on that one. Let me delete that and that. And now I'm going to use the sketch effect. The sketch effect is fairly new. And the neat thing about the sketch effect is it actually draws stuff. Now, to use the sketch effect, you also have to have the effect assist loaded up. Okay, this is the default image in the effect assist, and it has different paths. Okay, so you can put those paths in there, path one, path two. You can create your own path. If I start, now I'll tell you what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna start down here at the bottom. I'm gonna click to get a start point. Now I'm gonna extend this out. To get some controls on that so it's not a straight line, what I'm going to do is I hit the shift key once and then twice. When I hit it twice, it's going to give me two control points. If I hit the shift key just once, it gives me one control point. Okay, and now I can take that control point and I can manipulate that path. And if we go to shorten this down so it draws it a little quicker. Okay, you see there, it starts at the bottom and it goes and it just curves up just like that. In the effect settings, not the effect assist, but in the effect settings itself, get to it. Okay, I can increase the thickness of the line. And I can add motion. And by adding motion, what it does is as it draws the line, it will then start to undraw it. Basically, see, it slowly erases it as it goes. If you don't do that, it if you take out the motions, it will just make a path. And let me start another one. Okay, and it just draws things one at a time for you. Okay, but you can also Let me get to where you can read it. Import an SVG. Now, I haven't tried this bow, but we can try it and see what happens. Okay, it looks like we've got the paths on there. Let me do this, see if we can get a better. And it may or may not work because it's got so much to draw. Too complex. It doesn't like that one at all. So let me clear that, import another SVG. Might be this one, we'll see. Okay, that's the one I was thinking of we could use. It basically draws a tree, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to reduce the thickness down to 1. Okay, and you'll see it draws a nice tree. I could get rid of the color, change that a little bit. It's splitting it between the red and the white. We'll just make it green. All right, so now what it's done is it will just draw that tree for you. And what I did was I put the off command there and made the off command persistent so that even though it draws the whole thing, I can control how long it lasts with that off command, because it's going to take the last frame of the sketch and hold it and make it persistent. All right, so again, it works really great with what I call simple SVGs, and you can do it. It'll work. This one will also work, like I said, with any matrix or any really dense pixel pattern. Any prop that has a dense pixel pattern, you can do it. So another great way to use SVGs and come up with something unique that people haven't seen before. Question was, can you only get 2 points, not more than 2 on adjusting that. Okay, any other questions on using SVGs with the sketch effect? The key is to find the SVGs that are fairly simple. Another thing you can do is, okay, you'll notice that the way this is drawn, let me run it through here. The way that it's drawn, draws the bottom, then it does the sides, then it makes a jump. And what you can do is you can actually find the paths that are there. Okay, and you can move it up so that it draws in a different order than what you want to, than what it originally comes in at. So I move that one. Let's see how it draws. Okay, didn't move it up enough. Okay, so it only lets you move it up one at a time. So I'm going to move it up. And move it up. And move it up. Okay, now when it draws, you see that the left side, that path number 5 was actually in the order we wanted it. Now, so let's find that other one. That's path 10. It only lets you move it up one at a time. Unfortunately, this was just kind of added in. And you've just got to remember what you're doing. It changes the number each time. Okay, now you can see when it draws, it kind of draws those in order. The one above those should be up higher. That right there, I would move it up higher along with number 10. So 9 and 10 need to go up higher and come in behind 6, just to make it draw in order. But again, you can manipulate the order that it draws in.
Mike, there was a question on the previous, on the bow, if you could, if you're on a smaller bow, can you decrease the size? I know you could increase it, but can you decrease the size?
You can, and that's your drawing program. Like in CorelDRAW, I could make it a lot smaller, but I found I've had better luck getting them to work when they're larger. But yes, you could try that. The other thing you can do is, just go to Google and Google, simple drawings and then convert that to your SVG. And, like I said, it's a little hit and miss, but it's really good technology. It's kind of neat because it allows you to be almost an artist on your higher density props like a mega tree or matrix. Okay, anything else? Okay, like I said, these are kind of disparate categories, different things that I've used. All right, so next thing I'm going to talk about is Moises AI. I have used it for quite some time. One of the most important things you can do is actually import, is your timing marks. So let me upload song. Nope, I used the wrong upload. Hang on. Did it again.
I think you have to hit next at the bottom.
Yeah, it's, what's crazy? It's not showing up on my screen because of, there you go. I don't know if you can see it, but there it is. Yeah, it was not loading up the way I wanted it to because it was covered by the the Zoom stuff. All right, so what it does is it gives me options here. To how I want to break this up. Okay, I know there's not a guitar in there. There's vocals, background vocals, instrumentals, bass, piano, other. All right, let's just do this one. And again, submit it. Okay, it's uploading the song and it's going to separate it into individual tracks. If I click on it, it's going to take a few minutes. It's working on it. And like I said, it'll break it into vocals, background vocals, instrumental. And then it has a smart metronome. And I usually don't use those. We'll let it do its thing. It's usually pretty quick. I have tried it with vocals before and using, the auto lyrics to generate lyric tracks. The thought being, well, if I isolate the vocals, perhaps you'll eliminate some of the what I call slippage, you know, where there's a disparity between where the words actually start and the auto lyrics puts them. And I found that it really makes no difference. It's still only about 80% accurate, even when the vocals are isolated. So let me mute the vocals and we can play the instrumental. Okay, you can tell by that it would be very easy to put in timing marks using that track. I'm not really interested in the vocals right now, so I'm going to export that. And I'm going to just export the instrumental. Now you can export all of them. Doesn't really add much time to it, but you certainly can. All right, so now we've got a different MP3 that I am going to put into where we're working at. Okay, that's saved. Now, when I go into xLights, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go up here and I'm going to go to File and then Sequence Settings. And on the media, I'm going to change the media out to where I save this. Now your the length is not going to change, but the information that you have available there is. Expanded that a little bit. Okay, so now when I get over here, okay, what I previously discovered was that if you watch where the claps are, okay, the claps actually coincide with the beats track itself. What it's not picking up is, that other. And so what I would probably do to find the timing tracks on that, because it's a little fast, I'm going to drop it down to maybe half speed. Create a new timing track. Yeah, empty. I'm going to call it Alt Beats. Okay, I'm going to hit these beats that are not part of the claps there. Okay. All right, so what I'll do is I will end up going through that entire song and manually putting in those beats. And the reason why I'll do that is because I can then focus effects in first off on those heavy claps, and then focus other effects, other props on these alternate beats that this instrumental is picking up. Is it tedious? Yeah, it's really tedious. But if you were to listen to the other music, and I'll change that back. Okay, those heavy bass drums in there, they stand out pretty good, but it's just easier to pick them out, like I said, without the singing. And so that's how I use Moises, is I will use it to identify things that are harder for me to pull out of the full MP3. One area where it's particularly useful is when you will, it's particularly useful if you will go to, if you've got a song that is like an orchestral, that is, lots of strings, violins, things like that. And a lot of times, because they all kind of interweave together, it's hard to tell where they start and stop. But Moises does a nice job of letting you figure out the track that it pulls out. It really helps you isolate those sorts of things really well, probably better than anything else I've ever seen, again, as it fades in and out. Okay, so now where you find them, let me add it in here. Okay, you go to Moises.ai, and if you you can do it free with its when it's free, you don't get as many patterns to do divisions. You get a few extra patterns. You can do a desktop app, which is what I've kind of got, is the desktop app that I use, and it's $3 a month. If you do a lot of sequencing, it's definitely worth it. It's a good tool to have. If you don't do a lot of sequencing, like I said, just set up a free account and you should be good to go. All right, so any questions about that before we move on to the next thing?
Michael, I see one question in chat.
Yeah, from Earl?
Yep.
Can you not run timing track scan against separate tracks that created? I'm not sure what you mean. Can he get on his microphone?
Earl, can you unmute?
Yeah, I'm just trying to, as far as like being able to actually process the ones that you imported in from the internet, from the that tool.
Okay, so all right, I downloaded, I've got this revised MP3. What are you asking? What can I do with it?
Does it let you process the beats against that file automatically as a new timing track?
No, I've never tried it. I don't see why it wouldn't, but I don't know that it would give you anything different. Because we have no way to adjust, for example, if I could go in and maybe tell it, below this frequency, I want everything below this frequency, I might be able to get a different result. But they don't give you that flexibility to adjust it that way.
Okay.
But yeah, it would be nice, because then, if you could run it again and then pull out separate parts of the beats, it would make it even that much easier. Okay. All right. Any other questions? All right. This next thing.
There's a question about if Moises can create a MIDI file.
And let me look. I don't use them, but we can look here what we've got.
I know there's a tool that does it. I don't know if it's Moises or another tool, but there is a tool that will give you that. Tool that we use.
Yeah. It's telling me I need to log in. I'm already logged in. Maybe that's why. Okay. All right. So when we come in and we go to this and the export, these are the file formats that we've got. MP3, M4A, and WAV file. So I'm not seeing anything else. No. So I think the answer to that is no, at least not with what they make available in their desktop app. Let's see if there's anything over here. Nope. I'm not seeing anything that would be helpful, though, for at least to that end. Okay, the next thing I'm going to share with you, this is really cool. It has a steep learning curve, but it really gives you an opportunity to generate some things that you wouldn't be able to otherwise. Okay, the program itself is Magic, M-A-G-I-C editor. Cancel that. And what it allows you to do is create different effects and tie them to your music. The ones that you see here are the presets that they have. And so let me show you one of the things you can do. Find a nice Christmas. Okay, so we want to show you what the image star field is going to look like. Okay, all I did was I went in and I loaded that Christmas bell. And it's like that. Now, what I can do with this star field is let's change some things according to the music. Can do volume there. All right, so let's see what we get. Okay, that's probably blowing you out. I apologize about that. We'll reduce that. Okay, these boxes here, it's kind of interesting. What you can do is you can add in, you can insert controls. And you start with the magic and you can kind of follow how it goes through these various things. Right now, for example, on the stars, I've got it red, green, and blue. If I change everything to one on red and green, okay, now I've changed the stars to white. I can also adjust that according to the music source and change the color, and it will change with the music. And the nice thing about it, okay, there is a free version. The only thing about the free version is you cannot export MP4s, but you can export movies. You can also have, for example, you can set the time over here. Like I've got this one set for 132 seconds, but you can match the timings to when you want to change your effects and it will automatically go through the various effects that are here. Let me see, this is spider silk. Fractal kaleidoscope. Let me find that up here, make sure we're pointed to source one. Yep. Okay, this one is fractal kaleidoscope. And if I hit play. Okay, now not all of them are pointed towards right now. Not all of them are pointed towards it. But another thing that's really interesting about this is you can actually bring in shaders. And it's got a facility where you can bring in the shaders and add these control parameters to the shaders that we normally use. Let me get here, this one's shader. Another fractal, select the source here, one, source one. Okay, again, it's called Magic. Let me get to the website so you can reference that. The website is magicmusicvisuals.com. One word, magicmusicvisuals.com. And like I said, you can download a free version. And if it's something that you think you would use, I think, you know, a lifetime license was around $45. Let me get back to where I was. All right, let me see. Okay, this is a rotating rainbow. It's got a lot of stuff going on there. Make sure that that's set right. You got to set the sources in there. That's a little bit of a hassle, but not too bad. Okay, I think I got most of them there. Anyway, so that's a tool that you can use that will help you generate all kinds of visuals for a matrix or a tree. You can also, when you export, you can pick the resolution that you want to export it at. So anyway, that's one that I thought you might find useful, might find interesting. Okay, any questions about that one? If you're interested in MIDI files, there's some good information in the chat. Somebody's got a plugin for Audacity that will create MIDI files for you. Okay, any questions about the this little program, this little tool that you can use? Like I said, most of them are the little things they have here, these sample ones that they have. They are actually, they come with the program and you can just manipulate them. Like I said, real steep learning curve. There are YouTube videos that help you with it. But it is very, very, very powerful. All right, next thing I want to talk a little bit about is, let me get out of that, save that, get out of here. Okay, I don't know if any of you have been playing with AI, but I got to tell you, it's really a lot of fun. One of the issues you have as a commercial sequencer, of course, is you have to be careful not to violate copyright when you are using an image. So a lot of the AIs will give you some copyright-free images that you can use, and you can actually generate images. The one that I like, just because of the quality of the images I get, is Midjourney. It's a little interesting, a little more complicated to get set up because it's through Discord. What you'll need to do is you know, they don't really offer the free ones anymore. So what you'll have to do is actually get a subscription. For me, it's $10 a month, and that's more than I would ever use in terms of image generation. I've got Creative Fabrica is a group that I belong to that provides royalty-free images. So what you'll need to do, you need to go to Midjourney, and Midjourney has a web page. Okay, and in Midjourney, what you'll need to do is actually establish an account. And after you have your Midjourney account, then what you'll need to do is set up an account in Discord, and then create your own server and add the Midjourney bot to that. Now, let me show you what we can do here. All right, somebody in chat, type something Christmassy. What do you want to see? And we'll give it a try. Somebody be creative. Okay, Christmas Corgi. Okay, the prompt that you use is imagine. And Christmas Corgi. Let's do it, 8K, photorealistic. See what we get. Okay, I'm queued up. Okay, the Corgi process has started. Okay, there's our Christmas Corgis, and you can pick and choose which ones you like. You can tell it, for example, I can open it up in a browser, and you can see what we've got there. And, okay, let me close out of that. I know, super cute stuff they come up with. All right, let me get back to my Discord. Now, if there's one that you like, let's say there's 1, 2, 3, and 4, you can upsize the one you like. I kind of like 2. And what it's going to do is it's going to give you the very highest resolution, and it'll generate that. Okay, let me see what else we had here. Okay, I'm going to tell it cat wearing Santa Claus hat. I'm going to do high resolution, but I'm going to tell it cartoon. Now, this one even has a Santa Claus suit on it. Here's one that I tried. Victorian home decorated in Christmas lights at the end of a long driveway. And we will do photorealistic. Now you gotta remember I'm crawling here. I'm not really that good with these, but you'll be surprised some of the things that you can get just by entering these prompts in. Okay, you write less than a complete sentence, and these are some of the results that you can get. Really, really good potential to generate graphics for just about anything. But I just thought I'd share that with you. The other thing that it does, which is really kind of neat, is you can give it a seed picture, and it can generate images from that. Hang on a second here. Let me get back to my account. Okay, so it keeps a record of what you do on the website in your Midjourney account. Here's the little guy that I used as a singing singer in. This one right here is kind of interesting because I used a seed picture of Diana and told it to make her into a fairy princess. It's a pretty good likeness of her, except for it got her nose wrong. Her nose is a little broader and her face is a little rounder on the sides right there, but it did pick up the majority of her features, got her hair and stuff like that. Really neat that you can give it a seed image. The other thing that's kind of neat, let me go back, is when you have an image, here's one that I generated, you can actually see related images that it has generated, and it will show you the prompt. So you can generate something and then go look and say, well, I would have liked for it to be more like this, and then it will show you what the prompts are. That's what you're seeing pop up there. Like this one was a dense fog surrounds a bright photorealistic Christmas tree in the middle of a pine forest. And there you've got it. So interesting that you can do that. But I wanted to share, one of the AI tools that's out there for you. One of the issues, and it hasn't been resolved and it won't be resolved at our level. Bing Image Creator gives you 100 free fast prompts a day. Yeah, it is neat and a little scary. I agree, it's scary. There are lots of tools out there. I don't know why. I guess I like that Victorian Gothic look. You can actually tell Midjourney to use a different style. You can use In the Style of, for example. Let me get back to where I was. For example, I told it, give me zombies close up, and then give me a zombies in the style of Michael Jackson's Thriller. And the results were very different just by telling it, specific things to use. All right, so I just wanted to show that with you. That's something you can use to make graphics. There are lots of them out there. There's one called Recraft. It'll give you really simple images, and you can get them. They will even come in an SVG format. Just look up Recraft, R-E-C-R-A-F-T, and that's another good image generator. Generates a lot more for, displays. Where you don't need quite the resolution that this one will generate for you. Okay, any questions before I move on to the next topic? Anything? Nothing?
Nothing.
All right, great. We're moving right along. Looks like we've got a little bit of time left, another 30 minutes or so. I'm going to show you some tree manipulations that I consider to be kind of advanced. I am going to go ahead and switch to a layout where I've got two trees. Switch over to our traditional layout. Discard all those changes. Okay, this layout, I've got two trees in here. I'll show you this first one. The first one is 32 strings. It's got 160 pixels. The second one over here is a 16 by 50. And what I found generally is that a 32 string and a 16 string tend to be the most common sizes on displays. The 16 by 50 obviously is very popular. All right, so let's go take a look here, and I'm gonna go into the sequencer and I'm going to just create an animation. All right, let's go down here to our two trees. I'm going to insert some layers on the high definition one. Okay, so now I've got some things here on the high definition. All right, so insert a couple layers here. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to insert Yeah, not really an image. Let's want something that has a little bit of detail on it, but not a huge amount. All right, we'll go ahead and do this. Okay, I just put a single line on that, and I'm going to change the render style to single line. And I'm going to go from a chase to skips. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to manipulate the number of skip sizes. I'm increasing it. Let's see what we got here. Let's advance that. Okay, so on our tree, we get a red and white like that. Now, if I take that exact same effect and I put it on the 16 by 50, get them all lined up. Okay, you can see, let me pull this down here, that they look very different. Okay, you're not getting the same effect on the other one. Okay, because I want to speed this up a little bit, what I'm going to do is I'm going to replace that effect. I'm going to go from a single strand to the marquee. And the reason why is you can get the same thing, except for the marquee is just a little faster. See, I can speed up the marquee quite a bit. Whereas with the skips, you really can't. The skip is a little more staccato and the marquee is a lot smoother and you can make it a lot faster. But again, that's the marquee. And the render style is a single line. Okay, if I do the same thing, copy, and just paste that. Again, looks very different. All right, so what I can do is I can take this. I'm going to highlight that, and I'm going to come over here to the left where it says Mega Tree 32 by 160. I'm going to right click, I'm going to select model, and then I'm going to tell it to render and export the selected model effects. Up here, I am going to call this class example AVI. Now, it is going to be stored as an uncompressed AVI video. So I will go ahead and tell it OK. And you'll notice everything on my screen kind of grayed out for a second while it did that. Now I'm going to go over to the lower resolution tree. Match it up. Align the times. And then on this tree, I'm going to go down to class example AVI and select it. All right. You'll notice it's a lot darker than the other one. You'll have to increase the brightness. In this instance, considerably. To get it up to where it needs to be. But if you put the trees side by side, now you have basically the same effect on the smaller tree that you have on the larger tree, even though it would be almost impossible to do that using those single lines. The neat thing that you can do by doing this is you can take high resolution images that you put on your higher resolution tree, create an AVI, and then put it on the lower resolution tree. And for whatever reason, it ends up looking a lot better than what you would get by putting the original on that tree. Plus, like I said, it helps you match the effects exactly. So a lot of times what I will do is if I put the effect on the smaller tree and it doesn't look good, I will go ahead and produce an AVI and try the video to see how it looks. And in some instances, I have put the entire set of effects into an AVI and put it on the lower resolution megatree. All right, so any questions about that one? Question is, if you increase the brightness on the higher resolution, does it make it brighter? Don't know, let's try it. Only takes a second. I'm gonna go over here and we will increase that brightness. Okay, I increased the brightness on the source to 400. Again, I'm gonna model, render and export. Let's call it class example two. All right. Select the video. And I would have to say no. I mean, it looks like it might be slightly a little brighter, but it really, really not enough to be significant. But that was a good thought. Okay, any other questions about that? All right, along these same lines, using that little technique, let me show you something that I've run across and kind of my solution, I guess. Let's say, I want to put I want to create a background. And on this background, let me just change that to this. It'll be a little easier. Okay, that is basically just a pinwheel effect on the mega tree. And I'm going to start manipulating that a little bit. I'm going to go all the way over, all the way down. I'm going to copy that. And then I'm going to move that one all the way over. Copy it again. This time I'm going to move the Y all the way up, maybe. Okay, and then I'm going to take that one, copy it down, move the Y all the way over. I'm not getting enough separation, so let me take this. I'm going to change the thickness on that, bulk edit it. And let's try 50, around 50. Okay, so now we're getting kind of a neat little effect. All right, so let me highlight that again. We're going to highlight those, and I'm going to go model, render, and render supported selected model effects. I'm going to do that, and this one I'm just going to call corner swirls. Okay, now it's generated the corner swirls. I'm going to delete those. I'm going to put video on the same tree. Now, this time it's going on the tree. Find my corner swirls, maybe. I definitely didn't like that.
Did it need to have an extension?
Maybe that AVI extension. I'll just run it again. Used to not have to require that, but maybe they've changed it.
Just change your dropdown down there and do all files.
Yeah, I could. It's easier to do this. I'll just do this. We'll try with the corner swirls. There it is. Yeah, it just didn't take the extension. Okay, so. Take that. We're going to delete these. Go ahead and grab the corner swirls again. All right, so now I've got that little thing going there. Really haven't gained anything because it's exactly the same. I can also, though, put that over there. So now I've got it, and it looks pretty close to that one. But let me start doing some things. I'm going to take this one, and I'm going to change it to 2 is a true unmask. And now I'm going to put a spiral on it. Reduce the thickness, increase the speed. Okay, let me take that and I'm going to put that in again. Match the times. Okay, typically what I'll do, because that's a 16 as opposed to a 32, is I reduce the number of spiral wraps by half. So if it's 2, and then I'll change it to 1. And you can see now it's a lot closer. All right, so when you've got this and you're using you can put all kinds of things on there. Let's take that. Let's rotate it 90 degrees. Reduce the number. Okay, so what that lets you do is it lets you, you know, take multiple layers and, you know, do all kinds of neat things by putting something, you know, that you can then make as the background, I guess is the best way to describe it. There are some instances, and not in the example I gave you here, but there are some instances where when you have multiple things underneath it, because this says make two, it two is an undelete. Sometimes it doesn't work unless you layer it that way. But it does help you match up the higher resolution tree and the lower resolution tree. All right, that is all I had to share with you today. So any more questions on that before we call it a day?
Michael, when you've got two different resolution trees, are you better off building to your higher resolution and then exporting, say, the entire model? And
not always. What I'll do is I will, you know, I try to put the effects on there and then just make a decision. I don't always do it just simply because, you know, which from my perspective, and I guess anybody else's, you want the best image you can get on that tree. And that's what I use to determine if the video is better, I'll just do the video.
Hey, I got a quick question about the difference between configuring the settings and just playing the AVI on the render time. Does the render time increase when you're using the AVI?
No, it should be identical.
Okay, that's cool.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, when you're, you know, if you're not ending on a timing mark like this one, a lot of times what I'll do is I'll take the video and match it to the start time on the left and the end time on the right, just to make sure that it is identical.
Yeah, that totally makes sense. That times it all out just perfect then.
Yeah. Yeah, and then you don't get that, you know, blue screen. You know, I'm looking for something that ain't there.
Well, I think this is a fantastic session.
Well, thank you.
thank you so much for sharing your wisdom.
Thank you. You know, it's been a long day. 5 hours is a long time to talk.
This has been
incredible. Now we know why most preachers just do two sermons, right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And we're going to a comedy club tonight, so that'll be my break.
There you go. Let somebody else talk.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. All right. Well, I hope everybody has a great lighting season. I know things are starting to gear up for us, and I'm super excited about this year, working on Halloween stuff, and still have another 8 to 10 sequences I want to get done on the Christmas side. So it's been a busy year.
Thanks, Michael, for everything you do for the community and stuff, and you know, you and both. Yeah, you and your wife Diana. You know, you guys make a big difference to a lot of people out there. So especially doing things today, you guys really went above and beyond. So thank you very much.
Well, thanks. That's very nice.